opportunity to make some really good changes. The things in those revised regulations that are really good, that are really powerful, and are going to be really good for kids. At the same time, there's still some areas that are kind of unaddressed in those new regulations, but because every district in the state is going to be changing their policies, it gives them an additional opportunity for you to go above and beyond. So there's this baseline that DPI is setting, but then there's things that you can do in the district that are going to step it up another notch and make your policy that much stronger, that much more protective. So we're going to talk about things that you can do at a district level in order to achieve that goal. And then we'll talk a little bit about some strategies for how you can kind of leverage your district or how you can pressure your district to make those changes so that you're really prepared to maximize this opportunity. And if we have time at the end, we'll open it up for a little bit of conversation about other policy questions a lot of us are facing, especially with regard to CRT. All right. So when we look at this up here, can you give me like a big thumbs up? Like, yes, I'm totally familiar with everything that's listed on this page. Like in the middle sideways, I'm kind of familiar with some of these things. Thumbs down is like I know nothing. So we're talking about federal law, including Title VI, Title IX, ADA, IDEA. Okay, and then Wisconsin statute 118.13, are people familiar with that too? Kind of? Okay. So let's stay on that slide before. So what we've got is we're working in a system where the federal government has a set of laws that govern non-discrimination in schools, and then our state government has a set of laws that govern non-discrimination in schools. They're a little bit different because the federal government treats all these different kinds of discrimination separately. So we've got Title VI, which addresses racial discrimination, national origin, ethnicity. We've got Title IX, which addresses sex and gender discrimination. And in the last couple of years, it's been definitively expanded to encompass gender identity and sexual orientation. We've got the IDEA, ADA, Section 504, so the laws that govern disability discrimination. And then we've got a bunch of Department of Education guidance related to those. At the state level, we also have laws that prohibit discrimination against kids. What's a little bit different about the state is that it's all encompassed in one statute, which is Wisconsin Statute 118.13. And so that applies kind of the same standards to all these different categories of discrimination. But the first step for 118.13 and for its implementing regulation, which is Wisconsin Administrator's Code PI-9, is that the district itself, the local district, has to have a policy for dealing with those situations as they arise. So we've got the federal government, the Office for Civil Rights, we've got the state government and DPI, that are both ready to step in and intervene if there's a problem with discrimination that's happening in the school. But the only way that you can really get to DPI or to OCR is if you go through a school level process first. And what is contained in that school level process is determined by DPI with some sort of guidance and influence from federal regulations. But there's a lot of latitude that's given to districts. Districts have a lot of freedom to set their own policies. And so that's where we start to see some weaknesses and some problems crop up. So before we dig into that, we're just going to do a really quick review of what counts as discrimination. So what are these policies out to prohibit? Our statutory language is kind of vague. It says no person may be discriminated against, denied admission to any public school, or be denied participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be discriminated against in any curricular, extracurricular, pupil services, recreational, or other program or activity because of protected status. And then there's that long list of protected status. So it basically says you can't discriminate in school. Schools, you can't discriminate against your students. But what does that mean? We're going to talk about kind of concretely what discrimination looks like when it happens in schools. So there's kind of three main categories or buckets of types of discrimination that we see in schools. And these are intentional discrimination, so just like straight up treating students differently based on protected status. There's what's called disparate impact, And then there's what's called a hostile environment. We'll take a minute to talk about each of those. So intentional discrimination is like just treating kids differently based on their protected status. And it kind of requires two things. There has to be that different treatment, one kid treated differently from another, and it has to be motivated by their race or their sex or their disability or whatever their protected status is. So some examples of it might be giving more educational resources to members of one group than another group, or having like policies that are neutral, but that sort of subliminally or by proxy target kids of one group more than another. So a classic example of that would be dress codes, where all it does is like prohibit, you know, revealing clothes and like too tight pants and tank tops, and so you know it's targeting girls, even though it's sort of a neutral description of clothing. Another kind of intentional discrimination would be if you've got a neutral policy, but teachers apply it differently to students of different protected groups. So a classic experience of example of that is if you've got a disciplinary policy that prohibits some sort of vaguely worded behavior, like no loitering or no disrespectful behavior. And then it turns out that kids of color are punished for loitering or disrespectful behavior much more often than white kids are, because it's kind of vague and subjective what counts as, you know, that as loitering. And so it sort of winds up that the kids of color are targeted more often. So it's it can be tricky sometimes to know whether those things were racially motivated. Oftentimes, we think about two ways of proving that something was racially motivated, a direct method and an indirect method. The direct method is if the person who treated the kid differently said something suggesting that it was motivated by discrimination. So at the same time as they did the thing, they say girls are always doing this, or black kids are always doing this, you know, some kind of expression that suggests it, or if there's like a pattern of that kind of expression that you can kind of tie to that behavior so that you just know that, you know, that that was what was in their mind. It's not that common these days. People are pretty good at like filtering their discriminatory ideas as they're acting in discriminatory ways. So we've also got an indirect way of proving it. And that's where you've got two kids positioned exactly the same, you know, same grade, same, did the same thing wrong, or like same sort of situation, and one is treated differently than the other. And then the assumption becomes that the different treatment was motivated by discrimination. It becomes the school's job or the individual's job to prove that there was some other reason for it. So I've got an example of that kind of process that I think is pretty interesting. I worked with a client who brought an airsoft gun to school in her backpack. And she was suspended for 2 days because she had brought a weapon to school. There was another student, both these kids were in fourth grade. My client was a black girl. There was another student who was a white boy who brought a jacket to school. And when that was discovered, he missed his lunch. That was the consequence that he had. And so there were two kids who had both in fourth grade at the same school, both had committed a very similar offense of bringing kind of a mild weapon-like thing to school. And so we said, well, they're similarly situated. There's the only reason this could be different is because of the race of my client. The school district came back and said, oh, well, there's actually a reason for it, a legitimate reason for it, and that is that the young man voluntarily turned over the knife, whereas your client, you know, we only found out about the gun when it was reported, airsoft gun when it was reported. So we looked in the disciplinary records, and what it said for the young man with the knife was, it said in like the write-up, you know, student X's friend told the lunch personnel that student X had a knife in his backpack. So it kind of undermined that assertion that it was because the kid had self-reported that the treatment was so different. And so because of that, DPI found that there had been discrimination. So that's kind of how that process works. You find two kids who are similarly situated and say the only reason for the different treatment is because of, you know, whatever the protected status is. The district then has a chance to say, no, there's a legitimate reason for it, and try and prove that, but then you have to test whether that reason holds up. So that's discrimination, intentional discrimination. Hope, do you want to take a page?
Yeah, I can definitely do that. So this sounds really similar to an example that Elizabeth mentioned with the neutral policies having sort of like a different impact on these two students that were similarly situated, except this one relies mostly on how these intersections of like often class and other identities come into play. So there can be a neutral policy that, I mean, there's some great examples here, right? But specifically zero tolerance attendance policies, thinking about my school experiences. So oftentimes there may be students that have parents that work multiple jobs, third shift, and sometimes those parents have to take their parents to school. For instance, I worked at a charter school and students didn't have access to busing. Their parents had to bring them to school, and so oftentimes there would be students who were late. But obviously, there would be a disparate effect on students who like might be in a certain category or certainly affected by these intersecting areas of oppression. And so the students who were often of a lower economic status would be greatly affected by the zero attendance policies because maybe they had parents that had to work multiple jobs and so they weren't able to come to school on time and they were tardy more often. And so these things kind of build up over time where you have students getting truancy notices from school social workers. But that doesn't absolve the school district from having to do extra interventions to make sure that these students aren't being negatively or overly impacted by these policies. So again, really driving home that point that school districts have a duty to prove that there was no direct intention, however, prove that no discrimination is happening, whether it's indirect or directly on purpose.
So it's in that situation that Hope's describing, where if there's a zero tolerance policy that's only impacting, you know, the lower income kids whose parents are working multiple jobs, the district could say, well, we really need to have a zero tolerance attendance policy because it achieves X, Y, and Z goals, but then it would have to prove that there was no other better way of achieving that. So they couldn't, you know, they couldn't instead improve busing or like do some other means of ensuring that kids have access to get to school on time every day. All right, and then the final form of discrimination that's kind of encompassed in these policies and these regulations and these laws is what's called a hostile environment. And so discrimination, what we're talking about is when kids in a protected class have less access to school, like are not getting as much out of school as kids who aren't in that protected class. And one way that can happen is that kids in that protected class are getting harassed at school by their peers to the extent that they can't participate successfully anymore. And where that becomes the district's responsibility is if a couple things are in place. First, it has to be the harassment has to be severe, pervasive, and persistent enough that it makes it hard for kids in that category to succeed or access the same level of opportunity as their peers. Second, the district has to know about it. So that could either be someone told them, or it could be, it was like so obvious, you know, so many opportunities to find out about it that the district should have known if it had been acting reasonably and paying attention. And then the final piece is that the district fails to intervene and stop the problem. So if there's that, if there's pervasive peer harassment, the district knows about it and the district doesn't stop it, so it continues to happen, that becomes discrimination and the district becomes responsible.
Elizabeth,
can
I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So when it comes down to, like, the district fails to stop it, are there examples of, I guess, how do you protect and make sure the district doesn't just, like, bring somebody in for a talking? Do you know what I mean?
That's a great question. And that's a really common pattern that we see is that the district will say, okay, yeah, we recognize that there's harassment, so we're going to suspend the harasser. But then the next day, someone else does harassment, and they get suspended. The next day, someone else does harassment, and they get suspended. So the district keeps relying on the same sort of not effective strategies. Another really common problem is for a district to focus just on like the isolated incident instead of addressing a systemic problem. Another problem is that the district has a duty, in addition to ending and preventing future harassment, it also needs to remedy prior harm. So if there's a child that's been traumatized or like really is hurting in some way because of harassment that they already experienced, it's the district's duty to provide whatever supports or structures are needed to kind of help the kid reconnect with school or succeed in a different way, whether that's changing class schedules or providing counseling. So that's a really common thing for districts to not respond adequately to both end the harassment and remedy its effects. And we'll talk a little bit more in detail about that going forward, but so that's like a common argument that we see when we bring these kinds of cases against districts, is they say, well, we suspended the harasser every time. And and the response to that is, well, if you kept suspending them and the harassment continued, you had noticed that it wasn't working. So at that point, it became your duty to take a different level of intervention. All right, so we know what harassment, we know what discrimination looks like in school districts, real personally. What do people do when they are experiencing discrimination? Where do they go? DPI has some rules about that. So these are the current DPI rules. There's a link to them also in that document that you access through the bit.ly. Currently what we've got is that the school district has to designate some employee at the district to receive these kinds of complaints. And then the district has to create a policy or a procedure. It says for receiving and resolving complaints from residents of the district, including a provision for written acknowledgement within 45 days and a determination of the case within 90 days. And then the district has to notify the complainant of the right to appeal. So it's super bare bones. It just says you have to have a district employee that receives these complaints. You have to give a written acknowledgement in 45 days. You have to make a final decision in 90 days. And you have to tell them that they can appeal it to DPI. And that's it. So that gives districts a lot of latitude.
Yeah, I can take this one. So in addition to those key points that Elizabeth named, the district also is supposed to be publishing these requirements in staff and people handbooks, and we'll talk a little bit more later, I'm sure, as y'all get ready to kind of do your own investigating to your districts. This is like one of the issues that we've come in contact with, is like we look for this policy, for the policy to be outlined, and oftentimes it's either really hard to find or it's not there at all. So combined with these requirements, I mean, honestly, specifically reading, procedure must include written acknowledgement of the complaint within 45 days and a final determination of the complaint within 90 days. We all know within 45 days, there could be a spring break that happens. There could be like multiple instances that happen over 45 days. And this is a lot of time for issues to kind of go on and fester without any sort of remedy that helps students.
So this right here is a list. So DPI said, okay, you have to prevent discrimination, you have to have a complaint procedure, do that. And so districts in the state have been kind of left to their own devices to come up with their own complaint procedure. A lot of them rely on kind of a boilerplate procedure that's provided by like a couple of legal organizations. NEOLA is a really big name that kind of sells boilerplate policies to school districts. So a lot of districts have that as their procedure, and a lot of them are just making up their own. And a lot of them are really problematic. And here's a list of some of the problems that we see in school districts' policies. So first of all, like Hope was saying, difficult to access, hard to find the policies, hard to know how to start the complaint process. They're really burdensome and confusing. It's really hard to navigate the complaint process. This is a big one, adversarial instead of collaborative. So the idea with this complaint policy is that the district is working with families and students in order to create a safe environment. That's how it's supposed to be. So the district, when it hears that information, should be like, cool, thank you for telling us. It's our job to provide safe, welcoming schools. We want to work with you to fix it. That's awesome. But a lot of times what districts do is they're like, oh, no, like, we didn't do anything wrong. Like, us never. And they get very defensive. And it turns into like a fight, like an adversarial relationship between the district and the family. There's a lack of transparency. It can be intimidating. People fear retaliation. There's like a lack of clarity about what discrimination looks like, so people don't know what they're looking for. People from the district don't know how to investigate, so they wind up not doing adequate investigation, not finding the facts that they need. And then getting to Ali's question, the district maybe finds discrimination, but it doesn't know how to respond. So we're gonna take, I'm gonna take you through a couple of examples of these different problems so you can see a little bit more about what it looks like in practice, and then we'll take a look and see what's going on in your districts.
Do you wanna go through each one, or do you wanna?
Are we running low on time?
It's 10:33.
I think we can go through a couple of them.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so what does it look like for a complaint process to be burdensome and confusing for the participants? One thing that we've seen a lot is, is districts requiring students to, or complainants to fill out a specific form that's really, really tough. It's like really hard to complete. So I'm gonna see if I can get this up on the screen.
I think I clicked one, but not the other one.
Okay, yeah. So here's one example of a form that's being used in a school district in the state right now. So it says, it's the grievance form. It says the status of the person filing the grievance, student, parent, employee, or other. And then it says, statement of facts giving rise to the grievance. That's not too hard, but you know why you feel you were disturbed. You know what happened to you, right? You can write that part down. But then it says, identification of specific state or federal rules or regulations alleged to be violated. So you're asking your student or your family to be a lawyer, right? You're asking them to know the law. But it's the district's job to know the law. So that becomes really burdensome. If that becomes something that you can, you know, like a barrier to entry to the complaint process, if people have to be able to tell you what law the district violated. Then there's identification of how the rules and regulations were allegedly violated. So not only do you have to name the law, you have to describe the interaction. And then there's relief requested or remedy sought. And again, that's like, that's not really a burden that you should be putting on kids. It's the district's job to understand, like the district is the expert in how to create a safe, fair educational environment. So by making, you know, by making the impacted student or family complete this really difficult form, you're kind of shutting people out of the process, right? Because people are gonna look at that and say, I don't know. Yeah.
Do you see people in this process outline here being denied access to a claim based on not following the policy? So like if I didn't fill out there are 2, 3, 4,
mm-hmm.
Is the district in practice rejecting the actual complaint by saying like you didn't fill it out correctly?
Yeah, well, not with this specific form, but I had an experience where a client, you know, listed elements of a hostile environment, and then on one page, and then on a separate page, describe in detail some other like elements of their experience, and the district only looked at the piece that was written on the form, and it ignored everything else. So it said, well, you didn't write that in the form, so we don't have to treat that as a discrimination complaint, and it only considered like the piece that was written on the form as part of the complaint.
Now, would you suggest or advise that they change their, you know what I mean, that district?
Yeah, I mean, so
does that happen?
Yeah, so if we look at the federal guidance on this, anytime a district knows that there's possibly a hostile environment issue, it has to intervene. It has to find out what's going on. And it has to, you know, if it finds a problem, it has to stop it. And it doesn't matter how it found out. So if someone turned in this form and just said, you know, I was harassed so much that I don't feel comfortable going to school anymore, and I told the principal and they didn't do anything, and they just put those facts in there, it should be on the district at that point to say, oh, it looks like you're alleging a hostile environment, so we need to like figure out if that's actually happening and intervene. And if you look at the federal guidance for sure and kind of developing state guidance, if someone did turn in a form like that, that just had those facts but didn't have the other part and the district rejected the form, it seems very likely to me that the district would be on the hook then for you know, deliberate indifference to those concerns.
Mm-hmm.
Another way that these complaint processes can be burdensome and confusing is when they require an enormous number of steps. So DPI requires that the entire process from the filing of a written complaint to to the rendering of the district by the decision be completed within 90 days. And some districts require an enormous number of steps within those 90 days. So this is a district where, okay, first of all, before you can even start the process, in order to access the form to file the complaint, you have to have a meeting with the school administrator. So you have to have a face-to-face meeting, tell them what their problem is. At the end of that meeting, if you're still not happy, they'll give you the form. Then,
imagine if the school administrator was the person you had the problem with.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, how are you going to do that?
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. So then you have to write out the complaint and file it with three administrators. The administrator investigates and returns a reply within 10 business days. So that's 14 days, 14 of those 90 days. Okay, if the complainant wishes to appeal the decision of the administrator, they may submit a signed statement of appeal to the superintendent within 5 business days after receipt of the response. So that's pretty big. That's like pretty quick turnaround. Superintendent can review it and like return a decision within 10 business days. If the complainant is still unsatisfied, they may appeal through a signed written statement to the Board of Education within 5 business days. And then it says the Board of Education shall meet with the concerned parties and their representatives within 15 days. So you see how there's like decision, you have to write a signed statement saying what's wrong with it, and within 5 days you get it to the right person, and they get a decision again, all that, and then you have to have this big meeting with the school board and whoever you think is like causing the problem. So that is a lot, and in addition to it being hard, it's so easy to screw up. So if you like miss it, if you do it on day 6, and the school board can say, oh, sorry, you ran out of time and now your complaint is going away. Mm-hmm. It means you lose your appeal rights because you don't get to take it to the appeal. So
is it legal to have a gatekeeper, the superintendent be the gatekeeper of that?
Well, so the guidance from DPI right now is that school districts have, you know what's best within their districts and are like best positioned to decide, you know, what steps they need. And so I don't think it's illegal, but it is certainly very difficult, right? And so if we're looking at this as a moment when school district policies are poised to change because of changing DPI regulations, this is something that we would really want to look at and really want to change in order to make these policies better. Okay. This happens a lot. So I was mentioning those informal sit-downs with an administrator before you can even access the form. A lot of times districts say, oh, we have an informal process. And we resolve complaints informally rather than formally. Sometimes an informal process is a good thing if it yields a decision that's good for everybody. But if people are strong-armed into an informal process, that's really a problem for two reasons. First, it means that there's not really a paper record of the situation that they faced, and it means that they don't have anything to take to a higher level, to TPI or to OCR, at the end of it. The second piece is that school districts are required to report to DPI any complaints of harassment that they've, or of discrimination that they've received in a given school year. And I think right now the reporting requirement is that districts do have to report whether the complaint was formally or informally resolved. But a lot of districts like don't even get to the point of like really making a record of the complaint before they do the informal resolution. And so that means that a lot of these issues, which are supposed to be reported to DPI in order to give our state agency a clear picture of what's going on with discrimination, they just kind of fall off the picture. And so we're not getting complete reporting because of this over-reliance on informal processes. We don't currently have retaliation protections for complainants or for required at the state level or for people who would like, including staff members, to serve as witnesses in these complaints. A lot of school districts have kind of threatening language in there that says, if you file a false complaint or a frivolous complaint, you'll be punished kind of thing, or there will be consequences to kind of scare people out of that. Mm-hmm. And there's kind of a, part of that defensive response to these things is there can be a little bit of gaslighting type behavior from investigators where they're like, are you sure that was discriminating? Or are you sure you felt that way? Are you sure it was racially motivated, that kind of thing? So people start kind of doubting themselves, and especially with this partner, with that kind of threatening language, it makes people a lot more reluctant to talk about what they're experiencing. A lot of district policies are not clear enough about what constitutes discrimination. So that's where we get that problem of people treating harassment as isolated incidents instead of recognizing it as a systemic problem. When in a sort of disparate impact type situations, people form a self will say, well, it's just in, treats everybody equally. You know, there's nothing in there about race, and ignoring the different impacts on different groups. And then also kind of gives districts latitude to provide kind of bogus explanations for disparate treatment. Okay, this is a really big one, so we're gonna take a second here. It is the district's job to investigate when it gets a complaint of discrimination, okay? It is not the job of the student or the parent or the community member to gather all the evidence and give it to the district so the district can make a decision. The district is the investigator. The district is the party, is the entity that has access to all the information that it needs, right? Because students don't have access to discipline records, students don't have access to data, students don't have access to the internal conversations that happen in faculty meetings. It is the district that has that information. And so it is the district's job to investigate and figure out if discrimination has occurred. But a lot of districts will do one of two things. Either they'll say, complainant, it's your job to gather all the evidence, and oh, because you didn't gather all the evidence, there's no discrimination, and you didn't prove it, so we don't have a problem. The other thing that they'll do is like just do this very like basic sort of cursory investigation. So they'll sit down with an administrator and say, oh, do you think there's discrimination? And the administrator will be like, no, I don't think so. Like, I think we've got good policies and follow them, or you know, we've got good kids, they don't harass. Like that, I mean, that almost that level. And then based on that, the investigator will say, oh, there's no problem here. We don't have discrimination in our district. So because the district policies don't provide sufficient guidance about what actual facts you need to develop in order to prove some kind of discrimination, you don't find discrimination, right? So we get a lot of inadequate investigations.
Yeah, my favorite part is hearing about the surveys that a lot of districts do, specifically like majority white districts will do, and they'll be like, what's our climate like? What's the racial climate like? And, you know, 93% of people will be like, there's no problem here, but you have like 7% of the students of color who's like, I am dying in this school. We've had like multiple students share those stories where like, the entire school is sort of celebrating this false culture of inclusivity while they're like actively suffering in the school.
And then the final place where a lot of school districts kind of fall down is with an inadequate response to discrimination that they do identify. So so again, it's that issue of solving isolated problems but not systemic ones. Another thing that comes up a lot is putting the saying, oh yeah, you were discriminated against, student, so let us teach you how to handle discrimination better. I have a client right now who's been dealing with pervasive racial harassment. Her school district said, oh yeah, we agree there's a hostile environment here, so we're gonna come up with a care plan for you. And in the care plan it says, work on controlling your reactions, you know, take deep breaths and leave, like try not to, it said, we note that you have a sensitivity to racial comments. So that's the district putting the responsibility on the impacted student to solve the discrimination problem. But that's not where that responsibility belongs. It's the district's job to solve that. Another thing that happens a lot is if there's two kids, one's harassing the other, districts will say, oh, we'll change the class schedule to fix it, and they'll move the impacted kid, they'll move the target of the harassment. Mm-hmm. And that's putting the burden on that kid, right? It's putting the burden on the kid that's already been targeted. The district needs to move the kid who doing that rest. So I think we should maybe skip this part. Do you think so? Okay. Do you have fluency in like navigating your school district policy manuals? Yeah. Okay.
It's the Bitly, was not the easiest.
Okay.
The Bitly, at least for us.
Mm-hmm.
Well, oh, just to have.
Okay.
Yeah. get, we couldn't get to that.
Oh, you can, that's an I instead, a capital I instead of a lowercase L.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
oh, okay.
In case that helps.
Thank you.
Thank you for the
that's probably
yes.
Yeah. I just have a quick question. This might be a dumb question, but like way earlier in the presentation, we were talking about like two students that were treated, you know, similar situations but treated differently.
Yeah.
I've heard issues where like people say, well, we can't share what happened to the other child because mm-hmm. that's protected. How do you navigate
mm-hmm.
that?
Mm-hmm. It's a really tricky one because we do have these like pretty robust people records protection. We've had success with some districts in saying like that the complainant can have at least sort of general information about disciplinary steps that the district took without like details or without seeing any actual records that were provided to that were like created about the incident. Like the impacted student can have information without having the records themselves. But different districts have handled that differently and kind of fought that battle not super hard. I think that one way forward for school districts might be, districts as part of their findings, we see that there's discrimination. We see that, maybe that you were impacted by the behavior of this person, and we, the district, will initiate a disciplinary process against that person, so that the person who is, but without then going into the details of the disciplinary process, so like really treating the discrimination complaint as a completely separate category from the disciplinary process, the only juncture being that the end, like one resolution of the discrimination complaint is initiation of a disciplinary process. So what that would do is it kind of keeps that privacy wall in place, but it does let the impacted person at least know that there was some kind of process that followed. And ideally there would be enough discussion in the resolution of the discrimination complaint of what was done wrong and what conduct was found to constitute discrimination, that they would have the resolution of knowing that the district had at least recognized what happened to them and was doing something about it.
So is that, and that's only something that's possible once they've like contacted like a lawyer or maybe Hilton DPI, right? Because like as a parent, okay, so like let's say my kid got suspended and another kid was in a similar situation and I have reason to suspect that other kid wasn't suspended, right?
Okay.
How I can't like make that case, but I to the district
right.
without them like saying, oh, I'm sorry, we can't share what happened to that other child.
Yeah, so that's a great question. So that's a place where it would be your job as a complainant to say, I think discrimination happened because I think my kid and this kid did the same thing, but my kid was disciplined more harshly.
Right.
And then it would shift to be the district's responsibility to pull up the information and decide and give you as much information as they could without revealing those records, which would probably not be much. But then if you wanted to appeal it to DPI, you might not even be able to look at the records,
but DPI
would be able to.
Got it, thank you.
Yeah.
So you have to kind of go through the district first, and then the district, protecting themselves,
mm-hmm.
says, okay, we didn't find it, but then how are people equipped with knowing that that's not a final resolution? Like, does that have to be stated in the policy that...
Yeah, let's move ahead. we're gonna go so fast. Okay, so DPI is revising PIN. Okay, and there's some good stuff in this revision. It makes the policies way more accessible than the school districts. The procedure has to be on your school website. So no longer will people be like hunting through policy manuals. They just go to the school website and find the policy. That is awesome. This is huge. Anytime a student or a parent says to any school employee, anyone licensed, so teacher or admin, I think I experienced discrimination, that teacher or admin will have, under the new DPI policy, will have to report that to the compliance officer, that designated employee of the district, and that compliance officer will have to reach out to the complainant and say, I heard you have a problem, you have the right to a formal process, do you want to do it? I'll help you fill out the forms. So it's like putting a lot of responsibility on the district to bring people into the process, which is huge. We can skip that page. This is vague. There's going to be a prohibition of retaliation under the new policy. So every school district has to have a line in its policy manual saying no retaliation by the district or district employees against complainants or people who assisted with not addressed by DPI. And I think the core one, so this is kind of going back to that list that we talked about before. So the fact that the procedure can be really complicated and burdensome and blah, blah, the layers of appeal. All that guidance about what constitutes discrimination, what you need to do to investigate, and what a good response is going to be, that's not really addressed in here either. That's kind of left to the district still. But the really big one is the piece about adversarial grading. So, talked about this before. Right now, a lot of districts like see one of these complaints and they're like, oh, it's us versus you, like conflict, right? We're in a fight now, and we're fighting about what's the truth. We're fighting about what we have to do. But that's not right, and DPI has been so clear about this, not in the actual regulations, but in the language that it put out discussing the regulations. And so this is not adversarial, this is collaborative. This is, you know, people in the district and the district itself working together to solve problems. And so if we can get the district to shift its framing away from, you know, we're fighting with you about what the truth is and what we need to do, and towards, thank you for telling us, let's work together to solve this problem, that's gonna be so, so, so huge, right? And then we like don't have this concern anymore with, I mean, the concern is so much less of people getting to the end of a complaint process and having a really unsatisfactory decision than having to go to DPI. It means that DPI is only gonna get involved, really, I think one way to think of it is if districts sort of leave behind the adversarial approach, there's gonna be very little reason for DPI to get involved, right? Because so many problems will be solved at a district level. Yeah.
I'm thinking back earlier to your example about the two weapons from the two different students and how those were handled differently. And I think one of the remedies that I've seen in districts in response to that is that what you talked about earlier also, that zero tolerance policy. So any student who brings a weapon is gonna be suspended for 5 days. Any student who's absent for 10 days is gonna receive a truancy ticket. How do you balance the desire to wanna work with individual students and families with the desire to be fair and equitable in terms of resolutions?
Yeah, that's a really good question. For me, it's like a matter of framing. Going back to this, we're trying to be collaborative and safe and not punitive and inclusive and, you know, maintain our relationships. So it's like, it's a lot about philosophy. I know that doesn't speak to everybody. Like, that doesn't, it lands with me, because that's how I feel about kids in schools. But there are people that doesn't land with, who kind of have a more retributive orientation towards things. I think one thing you can do there is say, well, you're at risk of creating a disparate impact type of situation. Because if, you know, if we create zero tolerance, we know that it tends to impact kids with disabilities a lot more often. Zero tolerance tends to impact kids of color a lot more often. You know, and so we're, by maybe eliminating differential treatment, by trying to be neutral, we're just setting ourselves up for disparate impact. And so, you know, it's not really avoiding liability or also responsibility. I think that would be an argument that would work. Yeah.
Could you tell me, is there like a certain word? I've been going through my district website and I don't see anything.
The trail I've used is like discrimination policy, and then I usually, there's like a link, but sometimes it's really hard.
Sometimes you can search for the statute. So if you look for 118, if you like are in the policy manual and there's a search function and you look for 118.13, because that's the name of the statute that requires the district to have that policy. And if you can't find it, we'll sit down with you afterwards and look for it.
I found a complaint form to help as well if you're looking for a form.
Yeah.
Do you all
want to
mention? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, I do.
I'm really curious about the guidance for district response to discrimination in terms of a systemic approach. Mm-hmm. And does DPI have, like, you know, for districts that are found to have a racially hostile environment, like, how do they guide districts? And, you know, you can't just suspend a student over and over. What do they recommend usually?
As of right now, DPI doesn't have a ton, but OCR, the Federal Department of Education, does have a ton. And DPI has been drawing on that federal guidance and saying, like, here, districts, the federal government's done all this work, so, like, look at that and bring it up. On that page, one of the first page of it is, like, a list of resources. And on that page, there's a bunch of OCR documents, including a checklist for responding to racial harassment, or I think is the term, a checklist for responding to a racial hostile environment. and it includes things like, you know, using curriculum to develop students' appreciation of the respect for diversity. It includes things like systemic anti-harassment or anti-bias training, staff training, you know, partnering with communities, like bringing communities in for so it's, you know, all the things that we know to do, the federal guidance reinforces that. So yes, look on that page and look into the census. Yeah.
I was just wondering, like, is it recommended that there are two policies that outline, you know, this is the policy of the procedure when there is a staff on staff situation versus a student or staff to student situation or student just, you know what I mean?
Staff on staff is a different category that kind of falls under Title VII in employment protections, and that's different from the student stuff because this is about, you know, students' rights to not be discriminated against by recipients of federal funds. So they're different categories, and for that reason, also that means that the staff on staff stuff is probably a little bit more adversarial, and there is going to need to be more like a due process kind of set up to those procedures. But with students, it's just, you know, the student's not getting equal access to school, and so the school needs to fix it. So that's why it's this less, it can be this less adversarial thing, it can be this more collaborative thing. A lot of districts do have separate harassment complaint procedures versus discrimination complaint procedures, which I don't know, I don't think it's totally necessary. It seems a little bit more confusing than it's worth it to me, but some, you know, probably for some districts it's appropriate, or they've made that choice. The way that I keep those separate in my head is that the harassment complaint procedures, what the district is trying to figure out is whether one kid harassed another kid, so it is between the two students. The discrimination complaint procedures, what the district is trying to figure out is if it created a hostile environment to the extent that the kid was missing out of school, you know, not getting an equal opportunity because of their protected status. So there are different questions, and maybe that explains the different procedures, but to me it creates more confusion than is really necessary. Yeah.
So obviously we have a lot of school districts with a lot of different policies, and some of them might be newer, some of them might be very old and really need to be revised and such, and it's great that DPI is bringing forth and being more transparent with things. Will DPI or ACLU or some other organization be able to come out with a template? We get lobbyists who put out things for laws, for example.
Yeah.
Is there something that's gonna be available for school districts to go, here is the gold standard template, here is language, because I certainly wouldn't know what language that's in current policies would be key ones to pull into to say this is not the right way to do it this way. But you know, having that piece so that you don't have to reinvent the wheel necessarily, and yet allow for the school districts to improve their procedures and such and give examples of how you resolve those.
Yeah, that is something that we're working on, is developing a set of model policies that we can share with districts across the state, and hopefully we'll roll that out this fall. But yeah, it's very important. One thing that I, you know, as we're talking about this, I mentioned NEOLA. A lot of districts kind of rely on NEOLA to provide their boilerplate. I can tell you a couple ways that NEOLA policies are wrong. Like, they're straight up wrong and straight up violate state and federal law. So one is that the NEOLA policies, a lot of them are framed in a way where it says only students and parents can file complaints, but the state regulation says any resident of the district or a youth person can file a complaint. And so those districts that have NEOLA policies are shutting down the opportunity of community advocates, organizers, teachers, staff members, you know, other people with an interest and awareness of what's going on in the school to get involved in that complaint process. And they're leaving the burden just on the kids who are most impacted in the families, who are like least equipped to bring them a complaint.
So there's, say that again, the only ones that can complain are?
Our students or parents.
Okay.
Instead of any resident of the district.
Got it.
The other place where NEOLA policies are problematic is they often say that the investigator will consider evidence provided by the complainant and the respondent, or the complainant and the district. And that's wrong, because that's putting the burden on the complainant to produce the evidence. It's the investigator's job to get the evidence from the district, okay? So if by saying to the investigator, you only have to consider evidence that's provided by the complainant, NEOLA is setting districts up to do an inadequate investigation and be on the hook down the road with DPI or OCR. So So if you can call out, I think a lot of districts are just like, oh, Neola, that's easy, and we know they're getting it right, so we don't have to worry about it. If you can call out these ways that Neola is getting it wrong, puts you in this position to advocate for policies that are, you know, legal and much better for kids.
I just moved to the suggestions for future policies, but I don't know. It seems like the questions might be.
Yeah.
Are you going to talk a little bit about the issue of critical race theory in this context, mm-hmm. and how that misnomer is impacting
schools
and teachers in terms of, you know, our policies and what we teach in the classroom?
I mean, I think so. We did a fair amount of work on this earlier this summer at the ACLU, and our lens on it is that, you know, critical race theory is a framework, it's an academic framework, but we all know that that's not really what's under attack, right? I mean, it's, so rather than fighting about what is or isn't critical race theory, it's like our position is, you know, school districts have to teach about race. They have to teach about it honestly. And there's a few reasons for that. One is that our state academic standards require students to learn about race at every grade level. Right, they require that to be part of the curriculum at every grade level. They have to learn about human relations, special focus on African Americans, Hispanic Americans, and American Indians. There's also a requirement that students learn about the diversity of cultural values in America, learn about diverse value systems. Another reason that students have to learn about race is that teaching about race can be an important way of that systemic remedy for a hostile environment. And we also know that culturally responsive teaching can be a really effective tool for closing achievement gaps. And if you've got a pervasive achievement gap that's longstanding in your district, you know that there's kind of disparate impacts on students in the way that the district curriculum is currently formulated, that it becomes a real responsibility to use the tools that are available to you to close the gap. So those are reasons to teach about race. And so kind of leaving that critical race theory argument almost to the side, you can say, we can fight about what is or isn't critical race theory, but we have a duty to our students. It's right here in state law. There's a whole lot of really clear reasons that we need to teach about this in our classroom. One other piece is that PI-9, which is that administrative code, requires the superintendent of the district or someone in the district to conduct a review every year to ensure that there's not discrimination happening in a whole bunch of categories, and one of those is curriculum and instructional materials. And so I think this is kind of untested, but if there are instructional materials that are only reflective of one viewpoint, that don't acknowledge racial diversity or don't acknowledge diversity of experience, I think there's a pretty strong argument that kids who are unrepresented are experiencing discrimination in their access to curricular materials, and because that's encompassed in PI-9, the same DPI regulation, this policy that we're talking about, the school district non-discrimination policy, could be a means for students or faculty members or district residents to raise that issue.
I just want to make sure, you probably answered my question, but I'm just curious because we've had varying degrees of access to disaggregated data. Is there anything in PI-9, maybe along the lines of what maybe you were just talking about, that requires board level to acknowledge or to get an annual report of disaggregated mm-hmm. data and different, whether it's curriculum? Oh, well, I was thinking about discipline too, primarily, but.
So not currently. So there are some reporting requirements to DPI, but it's not encompassed under PI-9 to have these annual reports. But in the revisions that are coming up, one of the requirements is that districts are going to have to compile and publish and make public and share with their communities a whole bunch of data about access and discipline and other things disaggregated by
awesome.
Yeah, disaggregated.
When are we expecting those changes to come through?
Waiting for legislative approval, and if it gets approved, I think the implementation date is July 2022.
Would it just in case there's some nonsense in the legislative approval, is it possible for us to access what is their list of goodies that they're
on that link that I gave you, there's links to the page that the page that kind of where the state government has compiled information about the different steps in the process, like different paperwork. And then there's also.
You can actually turn notifications on too in the yeah. system to tell you when the clearinghouse rule is called. Actually becomes fully published, and then the department implements after that point. So you can, it sends you a little email. It's like it's at this stage, or someone's requested a hearing or exec session.
Perfect. But this section, the DPI revision of PI 9, and then you click on this, and it's a lovely PDF.
Yeah.
And the things that are in red are the updates or proposed updates, and then things stricken out are the edited portions. So
okay.
It's really cool. There's also things like the timeline has shifted. So instead of 45 days, it's 15 days that are really helpful.
And are district administrators aware of this?
Sure, or their lawyers are.
Okay.
What time are we done? Is it
15? It's
15. Okay. Do folks have other questions, or there's a couple more slides that we can take a quick look at?
Can you go back to the bit.ly? Can you go back to that, please?
Yeah.
Did you need the bit.ly link?
Yeah.
Yeah, please.
Okay.
What's up at the
top?
Really sincere question.
Yeah.
Would a district's failure to persevere in identifying a reliable communication system for a student with a neurodivergent neurotype be something that falls under, you know, not having access to education, and something that would fall on, like, where does that kind of an issue, I guess, of access based on neurotype fall in all of this?
So if it's IDEA and fake stuff, it would be completely governed by the IDEA process, and the non-discrimination regs are pretty clear that if it is an IDEA issue, that it's going to be governed by IDEA policies. They'll sort of punt it over there. There's sort of an interesting question about like more systemic issues of, say, over-representation or under-representation of racial groups or linguistic groups in special education, and that might be more of an issue for this kind of treatment, but if it's really about provision of services to a specific kid with specific special ed needs, that's going to be it's going to be an IDEA. Do you think you could look at the last slide on there? So, so we were just talking about like. We're looking at a moment where DPI is requiring some changes, right? And those changes are going to be good. But we also talked about how there are even more changes that it's just going to make that would be better, right? And that's adopting this non-adversarial approach, streamlining the process as much as possible, not having all those levels of appeal and you know, difficult steps. And then being really clear about here's how you investigate and here's how you respond. Those are things that we would want to see in these policies. So how do we make that happen? So every district in the state will be revising their policies once these changes in the regulations go through. So it's going to be on the school board agenda, so pay attention. I would talk about calling up problems with the boilerplate provider, calling up problems with new policies, making sure that the district doesn't just like kick over to that, but really is thoughtful about it. This is big. Just remind your school board, like if you adopt non-adversarial policies now, you're preventing liability later, right? Like nobody's suing anybody. Nobody's saying anybody's culpable for anything if you're going through this complaint process. You're just saying, school district, we're letting you know there's a problem, you have an opportunity to fix it, and then we'll all be fine and we'll keep on doing the work at school, okay? And so if the district is set up to do that in a really effective way, then they're preventing liability down the road. I think a lot of times districts hear discrimination and they're like, oh my God, we're gonna be in federal court on a Title VI claim, like paying off rights and money damages, and you get defensive and scared right away. But if we can teach them that by adopting really student-supportive policies at the front end, like as soon as a student raises an issue, the district just like treats it like pretty normal and like figures out what actually happened and in a reasonable way and then like comes up with a reasonable response and makes the kid feel supported, then there's no district liability, right? You're preventing liability, you're protecting the district by adopting these kinds of policies. So like really hammer that rhetoric. I think a lot of times districts looking at this stuff, they're like, we're stewards of taxpayer money and like we want to protect ourselves from like hefty legal fees. Like that's the rhetoric that people will like reach for when they're talking about being really defensive with this stuff, and it's totally backwards. I mean, it's cheap for a district to have their administrator just like really talk to all the kids and like maybe do a survey and figure out what's going on and then come up with a good strategy, right? It's so much cheaper than having them pay whatever lawyer to do a really complicated investigation and then kind of
look at it. And then like the implementation later, right? Like when they lose big.
Yeah.
Districts right now that have to do exhaustive processes that are like absurd just because they didn't look into an issue at the beginning when somebody filed a complaint.
Absolutely.
Do you have a suggestion for sources for policies that's better than NEOLA? Is your recommendation like you really should start from scratch and create?
We're working on developing some model policies that we're going to roll out. There's also in the BIPI document, there's links to some guidance from Edison, which is focused on protections for LGBTQ kids, but, you know, discrimination is discrimination, and we've got the same state law that applies to, you know, all protected categories, so their guidance with respect to LGBTQ kids is also really good guidance with respect to kids of different races or you know, ethnic groups or other protected status. So this one's a really good source, and then the NEA has a really great document about students' rights that we went to.
I wanted to clarify your question from earlier. Were you asking whether or not the complaint process would cover a student that wasn't getting the adequate, like?
I think so. In the field of autism, there's the kind of, you know, the like looking at autism as a culture rather than as a disability,
right?
And that it's the environment, you know, the social model of disability. So like when the schools are actively disabling a student based on not providing, it's just that weird intersection, I guess, of what is covered under like a special education, you know, with IDEA, and what truly is kind of like a, you know, like if we're stopping a student from self-regulating because we're seeing it as distracting STEM behavior, are we, you know, it's kind of just, it's that weird, it's not that there isn't an IEP that is getting met, it's just kind of like we don't have collective efficacy as teachers, staff to understand all of the intricacies of meeting the neurological needs of students with autism in our schools, and when a neuromajority expectation is actually discriminating against a student.
I mean, it
might be some fun.
I still think the complaint process is applicable in that, because it's like a cumulative effect, and just like we talked about the disparate impact, like that's one of
right.
those things. It's not necessarily the intention is directly to discriminate from
right.
the student or keep the student from having a learning environment. That's just the effect, and so that's something that's important to notify the district, hey, we could do this better so that our students can be serviced more equitably.
There is also, I mean, this is my last bullet point on this presentation, is like just use the policies too. Like, I mean, you're all smart people in this room, and like even though the policies that exist in your district now are hard, they can be navigated, right? And like if you just use them now, we already start the process of like normalizing this stuff, getting districts used to just learning and responding to what's going on, sort of exposing places where there are problems so that policy revisions can be good, and experimenting, you know, like if it's a systemic problem with access for kids with disabilities that's not really encompassed by their IEPs, but it's more about how the district is structured, then that, yeah, try it. And we offer trainings. Hope and I will sit down with you and we'll talk through your process and help you figure out how to navigate your district's complaint process. Thank you.
so it may be in there.
Yeah, so then you click on policies. And you're supposed to be able to pull up your policy manual here. So I'm just clicking around because I'm not quite sure what they have it under. And they don't tell you. So let's see.
So this is an issue.
Because they should have a school policy made prominently featured on the district.
Would it like say a policy, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. I didn't search on there, I searched on somewhere.
There we go.
Oh.
Okay, so they have staff. Procedures for handling complaints about school personnel.
So we didn't see it elsewhere from a certain organization, policies together.
Complaints concerning school personnel should first be addressed at school level. I'm trying to think there's more, but that's one.
Okay.
And it's similarly complicated, it's a state. It's those steps that we talked about. If you complain, it's not that trouble. Once you complain, we submit a formal complaint in writing to the director of human resources. That's one part of yours. And it was last revised in 2016.
Right.
But they aren't showing you what the revisions are.
Sent it.
That's a process.
Sample.
Yeah. which I just sort of like doing today. So we get to like,
to begin the formal complaint process. Okay, so we've been doing that.
They don't even get the number.
I will.
Just get the address and phone number.
Thank you so much, I'm sure your contact, so really, you know, I appreciate it very much.
Did you get it?
I did, I kind of took a picture of it.
And see, that's like the.
So the one that I was gonna show, they had all those steps, so multiple days in between, that's what hers is.
I wanted to make the connection to.
Oh, no.
Well, my principal's here, so I'm gonna share that with her, so she's aware of this.
But how we.
Yeah.
Oh, good. School district. So we're here to present on listening library, but in terms of like the presentation, so I was thinking like, okay, so.
A person would find that if they.
The recommendation is for districts to have.
If they didn't know.
Colleges opposed to adversarial, so like, what does that look like?
Well, thank you, could you give me that?
You know what I'm saying?
Oh.
Like, is there?
I had to appreciate you.
Is it on the bit.ly? I mean, I can look, but just.
Can I?
Yeah, you can use my computer.
Or I'm gonna go on this one.
Touch me, no, no. So I had a little bit of policy language in there.
So we were.
So that was, this is like, that's.
Oh, that's the one I took a picture of.
Uh-huh. So that would be the policy.
That would be the introductory paragraph.
Okay.
Just set it as.
We're not a fight with you.
Framework.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're not a fight with you, we're working together to make our district.
And my other question about that is like in terms of these surveys, right, that like will capture, you know, in a majority of districts, that is gonna capture a specific perception. What else do you, because I'm also on school board actually, so I'm curious about like, how do you, what's the best way to really assess the student and family experience of a district?
Well, I think a lot of districts do things like create, you know, committees or working groups, so they would invite maybe some students of color and their families to participate in you know, a series of conversations, maybe looking at some data together, maybe, you know, like looking at the experiences of other districts and saying, like, we saw this, like, this is great to you, or.
That's it, okay.
I'm sure that there are.
Thank you so much, I really appreciate your help with this.
I'm glad we were able to look, I'm sorry.
Sort of.
I hope they do too, I really do.
And not some timeline might be okay, but.
What's your.
Yeah, not surprising, you know, sad to say, not surprising.
Creating spaces for the kids.
Thank you so much.
And do you find that, I mean, do students and families not feel like tokenized or singled out?